Una dintre caracteristicile pieței românești de avocatură de business este aceea că se manifestă încă în mare măsură dominația de către firme autohtone. Nume ca Nestor, Nestor Niculescu, Kingston Peterson, mușacii asociații Țuca Zbârcea, Popovici, Nițu Stoica s-au situat mereu pe taierurile 1 și 2 ale directorilor internaționale Chambers & Partners sau Legal 500. Totuși, în ultimii ani, supremația le este amenințată tot mai des și cu argumente care în termeni de business se numesc încasări sau cifră de afaceri sau chiar portofoliu de deal-uri relevante de către companii străine. Parte dintre ele cu prezență destul de nouă la vârf, cazul CMS Oldbach Navarro, a șasea firmă la nivel mondial și cea mai mare prezentă în România în acest moment. Un alt nume mare și mai ales de tradiție și prin prezență, dar și prin rezultate în România, este Wolf Tice, jucător regional care nu și-a ascuns niciodată ambițiile și realizările care au făcut din biroul său de la București flagship-ul activității în Central Eastern Europe. Dacă acum câțiva ani Wolf Tice gestiona în România tranzacții pe energie regenerabilă sau surse alternative, acum atenția s-a mutat către M&A și piața de real estate. Bună seara, sunt Andrei Cristea, bine v-am găsit la Legile Afacerilor la Profit TV. Alături de mine în această seară, o personalitate a avocaturii de business din România, un om care și-a legat cariera de ascensiune a unuia dintre cele mai importante nume din avocatura europeană, Brian Jardine, Managing Partner Wolf Tice România. Good evening, Mr. Jardine.
Hi, Andrei. How are you?
Fine, thanks. Thank you very much for your presence.
Thank you for the invitation to speak here this afternoon, this evening.
Legile Afacerilor on Profit TV.
Și noi vă mulțumim pentru participare.
Numbers for the beginning. 13 different countries in Central Eastern
Europe. Aveți o prezență constantă în 13 țări diferite.
340 lawyers.
It's hard to kind of pin it down because we go through different cycles, but right now I can say we've actually been in a growth cycle,
moment,
which is encouraging.
Putem spune că trecem prin cicluri diferite, dar avem o prezență puternică în România, de exemplu.
Macroeconomic growth. There's also been corresponding growth for the legal profession, so we've seen a lot of activity in those markets, and Vienna continues to be, let's say, the core market.
Piețe precum cea din România avem o prezență constantă și am văzut o evoluție constantă a activității noastre.
Okay, so now focus on Romania, almost 30 lawyers.
Approximately. Concentrați
în jur de 30 de avocați în cadrul sediului nostru în România.
The Romanian office, as you know,
da, suntem foarte mândri de biroul nostru din România. Din 2005 avem o activitate pe această piață.
We've assembled a very good team over the years. And I think,
ne bucurăm de o echipă excelentă, cu o prezență susținută de atât de mult timp, din 2005.
And, you know, because Romania has consistently been one of the top performing markets for the firm, the firm is
România
prepared
a reprezentat una dintre cele mai performante piețe pentru activitatea companiei
noastre. Because it's a very relevant market. When we look at the 13 countries overall, again, Romania is one of the most critical markets for the firm's growth and future.
Consider că România este una dintre piețele cele mai competitive pentru acest tip de activitate.
Well, I mean, my colleagues in Austria would probably beg to differ, but I think if you looked at the regional offices, that's true, and we continue to be, we have now a friendly rivalry with our colleagues in Warsaw. That office we actually acquired
avem
some years ago.
Avem o activitate care se dezvoltă în continuare, chiar avem o mică rivalitate prietenoasă, bineînțeles, cu sediul nostru din Varsovia.
And we're now a very strong team in Warsaw.
Avem o prezență puternică și acolo avem o echipă foarte puternică la sediul nostru din Varsovia.
Appropriate, because if you look at, you know, the market or the region generally, most
Această
experts will say that if you look at where growth is and what are the two sort of growing and important economies,
it's Poland
and Romania, whether it's because of population, because of GDP, because of domestic market potential, capital
potențialul pieței de capital, potențialul economic al pieței din România, dar și al celor al pieței din Varsovia sunt similare, ambele foarte puternice.
Yeah, I mean, Vienna has historically, as I said, been the top. It's where we have the largest concentration of lawyers.
Cea mai mare concentrare
but interestingly, you know, they're Austrian-based, but a lot of their business is in the region, so it's not necessarily reflected as office statistics. But really the unique selling point for Wolf Tice as a firm is the regional footprint that we enjoy. And so when clients come to us,
cea mai mare mândrie a activității firmei Wolf Tice este, bineînțeles,
operațiunea pe care o
dezvoltăm pe piețele regionale.
So they see, I hate the phrase, but we use it a lot, that Wolf Tice is a one-stop shop if you're coming into the region. So, you know, again, it's kind of cliche, but it's true in many instances. And as a result of that, also being a regional firm, and you mentioned some very excellent local firms and other international firms. We kind of sit in a, what I call a sweet spot, because we don't have ambitions to create an international or global law firm. So we're not a threat to the large international firms who, if they have clients doing deals in our region, would often approach Wolf Tice, rather than hiring, you know, five or six local firms in Romania, Serbia, Bulgaria.
So we can do that one-stop shop. So that's really the niche that we play in.
So we do a lot of cross-border deals that involve 3, 4, 5 countries.
Avem și activități cross-border care implică mai multe țări din această regiune.
But they don't have a full presence, or they don't have any presence, frankly, in Central
East Europe. So that's where we get a lot of our business care nu au o prezență foarte puternică pe astfel de piețe.
In 2005, when Wolf Tice put the flag on the Romanian jurisdiction, the practice area,
the most important practice area, was
energy or maybe renewable energy. But now the play has changed.
Well, it's a good question, Andre. Actually, if you recall, in 2005, renewables were not so hot. They really started to heat up in around 2009 after the law 220 was adopted at the end of 2008. And then, of course, we waited a couple of years for the enabling legislation, the norms. And then we saw a real boom in the industry in around 2012, 2013. Particularly with the very generous green certificate scheme that the government had put in place. So I would say the heyday, if you will, of the renewable energy was probably around 2012 to 2014. What we saw subsequently was a scaling back or reduction of these green certificates, which impacted many projects that either had not yet been built or were not yet connected. Some of the projects that had already been built and connected were grandfathered or already had the green certificates protected. So we did see a significant downturn in renewables, let's say, from 2014 until about, believe it or not, last year. And for whatever reason we're seeing now, well, I can offer some reasons, but we're starting to see a rebounding. And we're actually, the firm Wolf Tice, we've been engaged recently on a couple of interesting renewables projects. But I think
am început să vedem o evoluție constantă începând din 2012 până anul trecut a acestei zone a certificatelor verzi. Noi avem o prezență constantă și pe acest segment și ne implicăm foarte mult
pe acest segment de activitate. If they can sell or trade the green certificates, and there still is a market for those, then that's fine. But I think what you're seeing now is, and this is not just in Romania, it's across the industry sector, more and more of these projects are approaching what we call grid parity, meaning that the amount of money it costs to produce a megawatt hour of energy from renewables is the same as what it would cost for traditionally cheaper sources like coal or gas. And
as a result, you no longer need to have these government subsidies de to promote or prop up the renewable sector. So if you go to the average person and say, look, you're going to pay, you know, €1 whether the energy is produced from coal, dirty lignite coal, or you're going to pay €1 if the energy is produced from clean energy, solar, wind.
Most people are going to say, look, we talked earlier today about global warming or climate change. It's very hot now. You know, if people can feel morally good about it and say, okay, as long as it doesn't cost me on my bill,
tot mai mult interes
as the consumer,
more money. I'm often consumed equal.
I'd rather have my energy coming from clean sources than from dirty coal, which pollutes the environment, creates carbon emissions, and all these other associated problems.
You talk with passion about energy. I understand
vorbiți cu pasiune despre acest domeniu energetic.
Well, I have had the honor of sort of coordinating the firm's renewable energy across the region, so not just in Romania. As part of that, we authored we published a renewable energy guide for a number of years.
Am publicat într-adevăr, am semnat un ghid privind evoluția energiei regenerabile.
We haven't done it in a couple of years, frankly, because we saw the market is being depressed, but we see now new new, no pun intended, but new energy in this area. So we really feel that the time is right to explore opportunities for investment. And as you know,
observăm o evoluție acestui domeniu cu noi oportunități de investiții.
Like Star Trek. And now we see 2020 is less than 6 months away. So we're talking about the 2030 targets now. So this is the next benchmark
strâns,
that companies and countries need to work towards. So it's an exciting time. And I'm hopeful again for some of these technical reasons with technological advances
and other developments
in the industry sector that will be more sustainable in the sense that it's not going to rely on government subsidies and it will
avoid a lot of the, negative concerns related
to renewables in the past, that it's costing, you know, all these costs get passed on to the end consumer, that it's not viable commercially, it creates technical problems on the grid.
Bineînțeles, este un domeniu dificil. Ar putea exista reticență deoarece implică costuri mai mari. Sunt există și probleme tehnice care pot apărea în cadrul noastră de proiecte.
Renewable energy is not producing.
Do you feel that real estate is the new
în ceea ce privește domeniul imobiliar, care este opinia dumneavoastră? Credeți că este un star în devenire? Da, într-adevăr este. Este un domeniu care capătă tot mai mult interes. Este un domeniu în care noi am avut o experiență îndelungată și în care ne implicăm constant.
And with the crisis in 2008-2009, we saw a lot of these projects die or get suspended. So a lot of our renewable practice was actually
retooling, odată cu criza financiară, am văzut un număr foarte mare de proiecte care au fost suspendate.
They were building wind parks or they were building solar parks. So a lot of the underlying assets, which are the land, rights of use to the land, and okay, with obviously with energy projects, you have other aspects, including connection to the grid and things of this nature. So it's not a perfect analogy, but to the extent that the real estate sector was depressed, we saw that the renewables kind of pick up the slack. Now we're seeing, as I mentioned, there is sort of a mini renaissance in renewables, but at the same time, there's a very significant renaissance, I would say, in real estate generally. And you can only drive through Bucharest and see the number of cranes going up just across from the studio, for example. There's new office buildings going up. There's a lot of residential projects.
Dezvoltarea segmentului imobiliar poate fi văzută cu ochiul liber foarte, foarte ușor, mai ales în capitală, în București. Vedem foarte multe proiecte în dezvoltare în această perioadă.
Spre
o deosebire de perioada crizei financiare, bineînțeles, acum există mai puțină speculă pe acest segment. Sunt foarte mulți investitori interesați de această piață, de acest domeniu al segmentului imobiliar, însă există și foarte multă reticență.
Let's say what's happening in some of the other regional markets. I mean, you know, you don't have to go to Ukraine. You can even look at what's happening, for example, in
Hungary. Dacă comparăm acest segment imobiliar cu ceea ce se întâmplă pe alte piețe regionale,
Romania remains
putem spune că din punct de vedere geopolitic, România rămâne totuși o piață foarte atractivă.
Special bilateral relationship with the United States that Romania enjoys and which I've witnessed over the more than 20 years.
Un avânt l-ar putea constitui și parteneriatul geostrategic pe care România l-are cu Statele Unite ale Americii.
Andrei grew up on the East Coast, but I went to law school at UCLA and I practiced for my first 7 years as being a lawyer. I was in Los Angeles.
Ne puteți spune câte ceva despre background-ul dumneavoastră? Da, am practicat avocatura, am absolvit UCLA, Universitatea de Avocatură din Statele Unite.
I was a trial lawyer, so I did litigation. I went to court, and when I came to Eastern Europe in the mid-90s,
am avut ceva practică și
on business law.
În domeniul avocaturii business, de business.
The United States, I think that what I've witnessed over the years is that And I realize this is somewhat of a generalization, but what I've witnessed is that most Romanians continue to have that affinity towards the United States. You know, in other countries,
aș putea generaliza acum, însă ceea ce am observat în experiența mea de-a lungul vremii este faptul că în ceea ce privește mentalitatea românilor, există o afinitate pentru Statele Unite și americani pe care acest popor o are.
You know, and especially in many of the countries in Central and Eastern Europe where there is a legacy of having a social net and so many of these countries maybe don't consider, I mean, they admire the American culture, but maybe they don't necessarily
nu se rezumă această atitudine doar la România, toată regiunea aceasta, și cea din centrul central est european, se observă această atitudine de deschidere față de Statele Unite.
Optimistic about the United States in the sense of it being a country that,
există un soi de optimism legat de Statele Unite, în sensul că Statele Unite este văzut un drept un epitom al democrației. Oferă un fel de exemplu, dacă vreți, a ceea ce înseamnă succesul obținut prin multă muncă și voință.
That I haven't seen maybe in some of the other countries in the region, and I think if Romania can
însă
tap into some
acest
of that,
sentiment de admirație este mai pregnant în România decât ceea ce am observat eu în alte state europene.
I think again, particularly among some of the younger business folks that I've
în ceea ce privește tinerii afaceriști, la ei am observat o astfel de deschidere mai largă privire la imaginea Statelor Unite.
And gives me hope and confidence that maybe Romania will.
Vin și îmi spun de foarte multe ori că modelul american le dă încredere că și România la un moment dat ar putea atinge un astfel de deziderat.
The technology and maybe even artificial intelligence, Romania has become not a very important player, but a major player in the region.
Absolutely. I mean, we share in our office building is this, this Romanian unicorn, this WePath. There in our office building.
Unfortunately, the single Romanian unicorn lasts.
Yeah, but I mean, I think
în ceea ce privește nivelul inteligenței artificiale, aici România se impune drept unul dintre jucătorii importanți. Da, există o evoluție din acest punct de vedere. Și în cadrul companiei noastre de avocatură avem foarte mulți specialiști
has developed some kind of a new
care sunt interesați de acest domeniu și de asemenea avem și clienți care sunt foarte interesați de acest domeniu și cărora le oferim consultanță.
Dimitru Pompei, and you can see how much space Oracle has now, and some of the other major tech
sunt foarte multe companii IT care au bază și au pus baza în România și au deschis sedii. Oracle este doar un exemplu.
There are challenges. One of the challenges Romania has, I suppose, for many countries, it would be a good problem to have, is the level of unemployment is so low, and so this is driving up
wages. Există însă și probleme ale pieței. Unul dintre marele probleme care există, care se confruntă piața românească, o provocare, o adevărată provocare este șomajul.
Not so low cost, and that's you can't necessarily resist that. That's supply and demand. That's what it means. I mean, we saw this in Asia in the 60s and 70s. Japan was supplanting the United States and producing cheap transistors and things that, and then suddenly they became expensive, so in came the Chinese, and then they go up, and then in come the Vietnamese or the Malaysians. So it's a natural evolution and development, and I think for Romania the key would be to try and go and evolve towards those high value sectors where they can add value and where they still have
ce poate învăța România, inclusiv din modelul japonez prezent pe piața în anii 60-70, este să investească foarte mult în partea de valoare adăugată.
I think the government's gotten it right, at least up to now, in terms of incentivizing the development through tax.
Bineînțeles, și guvernul poate oferi stimulente în așa fel încât să ajute atât companiile, investitorii, cât și angajații.
The argument that it somehow discriminates against everybody else because they get these preferential tax breaks. I'm a strong believer in the idea that a rising tide floats all boats. So if you get the inbound investment coming because of the tax
ar putea fi o situație în care toată lumea ar putea câștiga automat dacă guvernul ajută la nivel de jurisdicție și ar ajuta cu reducerea taxelor, automat și investitorii ar fi mai interesați de această piață, toată lumea ar avea de câștigat. Este ca un val, dacă doriți, automat sectoarele economice au de câștigat de pe urma
I think, yeah, it's a valid question. I think that generally no, in the sense that if you look at the investors who are now coming in, they tend to be more sophisticated. Mm-hmm. They do a more thorough due diligence
on the real estate
assets.
Se observă totuși o schimbare în profilul investitorilor.
Not just, I'm going to buy this mm-hmm. land on
care
the ring road,
and
in a year I'm going to flip it and make double my money. This was kind of the mentality. I think
sunt
the people
mult
that are
mai chipzuiți acum, se uită mai atent la piață înainte de a investi, nu se mai aruncă să cumpere un teren și automat să investească, se uită un pic mai atent la piață.
I've heard from others who are much more involved on the brokerage side that in certain areas there is a sort of a mini bubble and that the prices are overheating and that there will be a correction. I don't anticipate it will be as dramatic as what we experienced in 2008 and 2009. There's an old saying that,
pe partea de brokeraj există temeri că ar putea exista o nouă bulă și automat prețurile ar putea crește din nou, deși nu cred că se va mai ajunge la situația din 2009, când a existat acea criză imobiliară a prețurilor.
Speculation, basically. So I think now it's a again, the quality and level of the people that are coming in and making these investments, their commitment
to the remaining market, their desire to bring good product into
the market,
so it's not just slap up a building, you know, that's going to fall apart in 10 years or that violates building codes, but coming in with green buildings or eco-friendly buildings. Really investing in quality and level of the people that are coming in and making these investments, their commitment to the remaining market, their desire to bring good product into the market, so it's not just slap up a building,
you know, that's going to fall apart in 10 years or that violates building codes, but coming in with green buildings or
eco-friendly buildings. Really investing in quality and level of the people that are coming in and making these investments, their commitment to the
remaining market, their desire to bring good I think last year, if I'm wrong, just tell me, the selling of Crystal Tower.
Yeah, that my partner Ileana was involved on
ne
that project.
Ceva we also were involved on the acquisition of the Landmark building, where a fost un domeniu foarte
atent. So we saw a couple of significant office park deals, which I think sent a positive message into the economy. We also were involved in the year before, in 2017, on the sale of the Radisson.
Da, a fost unul dintre proiectele în care ne-am implicat cel mai mult și în 2017, la fel ne-am implicat în vânzarea Radisson.
I always get a little uncomfortable on these in these interviews when you said that you've worked on. I have to give credit to my team because you know I manage the office and I tend to get my hands dirty on some of these projects. I enjoy getting my hands dirty still and doing deals. I'm doing a real estate deal right now, actually. An interesting transaction in the agriculture sector. But on those particular deals, I was not so involved, but my partners did an excellent job, and they work closely also with partners in our Austrian office because it was an Austrian component as well. So it was interesting to see again one of our selling points is our ability to work cross border, and so the partners in Vienna collaborate closely with the partners in Romania.
Este vorba despre o rețea mai mare de parteneri. Lucrăm în aceste tranzacții inclusiv cu partenerii noștri regionali, dar și cu cei din compania mamă din Vienna.
Looking one of the things that we've seen happening over the last 10 years since the crisis is also an expansion for the firm of true cross-border referrals and collaboration and not sort of the
ceea ce am observat în ultimii 10 ani și ne bucură foarte mult pe piață este o dezvoltare mai mare a relațiile cross-border, a parteneriatelor în diferite proiecte. Nu mai există acea departajare clară între manager și echipa cu care lucrează. Toată lumea colaborează cu toată lumea, este un efort de echipă comun care dă rezultate. Este un lucru foarte bun pe care l-am observat și în România în ultima vreme.
In 2008-2009, when the crisis came, you know, there were a lot of people thought, well, maybe Romania wouldn't be so affected because it hadn't yet really integrated because it had only been in the EU for.
Dacă ne uităm la criza financiară,
but I think as we saw,
foarte mult s-a așteptat ca România să nu fie foarte afectată, având în vedere faptul că făcea parte din Uniunea Europeană, deci era oarecum protejată.
Cross-border collaboration is really kind of tying Romania into being a true
active member in the region and frankly also in the EU. Pe care companiile au avut-o cu firmele mamă, cu sediile centrale.
Analysis from Romania, from business point of view of Romania. One of our strengths, you already mentioned the position geostrategical one, it's okay.
Unul dintre punctele forte ale României pe care l-ați menționat a fost parteneriatul, poziția geostrategică pe care o are țara noastră. Însă o problemă persistentă pe care o are țara aceasta este problema infrastructurii, lipsei de infrastructură mai precis. Da, într-adevăr, am citit și un articol astăzi legat de acest subiect.
highway out to from Pitești to Craiova.
Yeah. And this is critical. Promis autostradă între Pitești și Craiova.
Now it's a national road.
Yeah.
Between
well, and I understand they were supposed to start the drum național mai nou
între acum este un vorba de un drum național, însă să sperăm să se dezvolte.
These are investments that benefit all of Romania because it'll
encourage investors. Da, acestea sunt investiții necesare din care ar putea beneficia întreaga țară.
So you're definitely right. Infrastructure is an area that
ați menționat foarte corect infrastructura de tâmpunct fierbinte al dezvoltării economice al țării.
I mean, I can tell you, I was involved in 2004 advising on the project for the contemplated construction of the Comarnic-Prădal Highway in the distant future of 2008.
Noi am fost firma a fost implicată în 2004.
But the other area
consultanță juridică pentru dezvoltarea autostrăzii Comarnic-Prădal.
Biased being a lawyer, but it is again.
Deci cunosc această viață și problemele acesteia.
The Foreign Investors Council and others have consistently identified this is being a leading
iar una dintre problemele pe care investitorii le-au identificat și pe care care ni le-au comunicat au fost problemele legate de birocrație. Constructorii, dezvoltatorii de autostrăzi se confruntă cu aceste probleme birocratice, legi care se schimbă peste noapte.
Whatever the level is, or we have to pay this additional contribution. They'll remodel their business plan and then they'll come
in and say, okay, can we still make money on this? Yeah, we're not going to make as much, but we'll still make money. Fine. Then they go and make the investment, but then it changes again. And this is what really irritates something investors. It's not so much,
you know, obviously the country needs to, the government needs to make money. They need to bring in tax revenues from somewhere. So it's absolutely appropriate that they have taxes and charges against investors, you know, we don't want to see, this is the big, you know, just sidetracking
este evident
a bit, the big criticism
in the U.S.
companies like Amazon, for
aibă
example,
parte
that aren't paying any taxes
because of bani, the, aibă parte de resurse financiare de aici, de aici și taxele acestea.
I think what is very good that Romania has done was to implement the flat tax some years ago. Ironically, yeah. This is what the Republicans would love to do in the United States, get rid of progressive tax, and I think that's been one of the best things
that Romania has done over the last 10 years in terms of attracting
foreign investment, and that they've managed
România
to hold the line on that.
L-a implementat ceva ce și republicanii și-ar dori să facă în Statele Unite.
We've seen in a country as sophisticated as the United States, it's very difficult even to police a progressive tax system.
Însă un astfel de proiect este foarte complicat într-o țară cum Statele Unite.
Accountants to take advantage of loopholes and what you end up having is the people that can afford to pay these very smart advisors, they get around the taxes, and I think if you have a very basic flat tax, which is very comprehensible and transparent, most companies and individuals comply because the costs of evasion are higher than the costs of compliance. And so I think this is why it's important that Romania continue to focus on adopting rational legislation, that legislation
de aceea consider că este foarte important ca România să se concentreze în continuare pe adoptarea unei legislații corecte care să ajute investitorii să îi sprijine, nu să încurce.
And this idea they were going to have a split VAT, then they weren't going to have a split VAT. I mean, this is the kind of thing that really sets investors on edge because they don't have that certainty.
Această pendulare to write a check and invest, you know, how many millions into a country. They want to know that nu vom avea un split TVA, s-ar putea să încetinească un pic ritmul economiei.
The government said we have consultation also with AmCham or just foreign investor, but just after we publish in the...
Like bineînțeles, înainte de a se lua decizii, sunt consultări cu Camera de Comerț, dar după ce se ia o decizie de regulă.
Look, I'm encouraged that there seem to be a better appreciation now, from what I understand, some of the since the parliamentary elections, there's been more of a feeling by the government that they need to consult with the investor community.
Da, însă acest lucru se schimbă, mai ales după alegerile parlamentare, există o deschidere mai mare din partea parlamentarilor de a se consulta cu investitorii înainte de a lua decizii importante pentru economie.
And if you create a legislative labyrinth or you create a system that's very incomprehensible or constantly changing,
pentru că dacă creezi un adevărat labirint legislativ, dacă creezi un sistem foarte complicat,
they say, okay, do I go to Romania and they look at all the problems and they say, no, I'll just go across the border and
automat
build it in Hungary, which is
pierzi din crederea investitorilor, aleg să investească în altă parte și nu în România.
You know, that's there's a learning opportunity there for the government to say, what can we do to make Romania attractive?
Atitudinea investitorilor care aleg să investească în alte zone, dacă situația economică nu le este favorabilă, ar putea constitui o lecție importantă pentru guvernul României. Guvernul are de învățat dintr-o astfel de atitudine a investitorilor.
Whether it's taxation or regulatory regulations or whatever.
Totul trebuie să fie foarte transparent, indiferent că este vorba de lege sau birocrație.
That Romania wins the fight for being a rule of law.
Yeah, I mean, if you'd asked me the question a year ago, I might have had some doubt. I have to preface this by saying I'm kind of an optimist about Romania. I very much believe in the potential. I wouldn't be here, I think, as
long
as I have.
Pot să vă spun cu siguranță că sunt un optimist în ceea ce privește evoluția economică a României.
Here, and I think there's tremendous potential.
Cred că există un potențial incredibil
like
al zonei rezidențiale, întregului sector rezidențial.
Yes, that they are winning, that they are trying to fight. It's a difficult fight, and I have to underscore that it's not one unique
sector
to Romania.
There's corruption
everywhere. There's corruption in the United
dar
States.
Pentru
there's corruption
România
in Bulgaria. There's corruption
in
Bulgaria. But the idea is how you address that and how
cu mai multe investiții. Este o situație cu care se confruntă orice țară, chiar și cele dezvoltate, se confruntă și Statele Unite.
You're never going to eradicate corruption 100%, but you have to.
Nimeni nu a eradicat anticorupția 100%.
Like in the Scandinavian countries, and these are countries that really focus on building, you know,
există țări care sunt pioniere în acest domeniu, precum cele scandinave.
For example, making tax payments online, doing things in a very transparent
way. Precum cele scandinave care au eliminat foarte multe dintre fișurile birocrației, se pot plăti taxele online foarte ușor.
That park has been cleaned up, new benches have been put in, or that ring road is being built, or, you know, the hospital or the school is being renovated, and that's my tax dollars hard at work, as they say. Then I think
contributorii văd foarte ușor unde se duc banii lor. Văd că s-a construit un spital, s-a reabilitat un nou drum. Știu exact unde se duc finanțele lor, taxele pe care le plătesc.
But I think the frustrating part is when people read about they walk out their door and there's garbage heaped up, there's potholes in the road.
Automat,
they pay their taxes and then they read a news article that some politician skipped off to a Polynesian island somewhere
din casă,
and
has
stolen millions, if not, you know, hundreds of millions of euro. I mean, that's what
automat,
really pisses people off.
Sute de milioane de euro, de multe ori implicate, nivelul de optimism scade.
14 years ago. Do you want to stay here?
Aflați în România de.
Do you want to retire here, or you?
Well, actually, again, I've been with Wolf Tice for 14 years. I've been in Romania since 1996.
Oh my God.
I was here on a one-year contract.
14 ani aveți de gând să vă retrageți? I mean, da, sunt în România din 1996.
I had as much dark hair and as skinny as you when I first came. No, but I think that it's an interesting country. I mean, to retire, I never like to look that far down the road.
Este o țară interesantă pentru a te retrage, pentru a te pensiona aici.
You know, my wife is American. We have two lovely children. I have an 11-year-old son and a 6-year-old daughter. And we've carved out a nice life here. I sit on a number of boards. I'm on the board of the American International School of Bucharest.
Am o familie în Statele Unite, o soție, un copil de 11 ani, o fetiță de 6 ani.
Charities, and I believe it's a country where you can live well, it's safe. This is
da, România este o țară în care cu siguranță poți trăi bine, este o țară sigură.
It's appalling when you hear about all these handgun deaths. It's every time it seems like you turn on the CNN in the morning.
Auzi într-adevăr multe știri negative despre România. Dacă deschizi televizorul pe CNN este suficient pentru a auzi multe știri negative despre România.
There'll be a drive-by shooting. So in that regard, it's a very family-friendly environment. I think Romanians
cu siguranță
love children,
este un
really,
mediu propice pentru
family,
a trăi împreună cu familia.
Well. And I think it's a beautiful country when you, especially when you get out of Bucharest and you get into some of the countryside.
Dar este,
I mean,
cu siguranță
said,
o țară minunată, mai ales când ești din capitală.
And I've had it since 2004, and we've over the years developed it. And it's kind of a sanctuary. It's a way that I can unwind at the end of a long week. It's only an hour from Bucharest. Yeah. And it's a beautiful part of Romania. There's many, many beautiful parts of Romania. But as you mentioned, without the infrastructure, a lot of it you can't get to, or you can't go away for a weekend because it takes you a weekend just to get there. If you're talking about some of these places, unless you want to get on an airplane and fly to, you know, Bukovina or Maramureș. It would be great if you had highways and could be there in 4 or 5 hours. I think you'd see a lot more tourism into some of these areas.
Obviously, with tourism comes money and would help to bolster some of these local economies as well. Automat și economiile locale pot crește prin dezvoltarea turismului.
Look into the future. And let me know if you think that the Romanian lawyer, first question, it's difficult to hiring a good lawyer now in Romania.
Este dificil să angajezi un
funny you ask, because we're going through interview process now. I think actually there's many good lawyers. I wrote an article recently, actually, where I was asked to, it was in one of the legal publications, what I've seen change over the 20 years since I've been more than 20 years now practicing, and really what I've say in this article is the quality of the Romanian lawyers has increased so much because the level of sophistication on the deals to which they're exposed has increased so much.
Care so, aborda I mean, acest subiect
in the old,
și în care se specifica
well, yeah, and in the old days, I mean, the first or second year associates, their idea with writing
România
a memo was some
foarte,
esoteric
foarte
discussion
vreme.
About the history of the civil code. But more and more, the lawyers are coming out and they're working as interns or they're getting real-world experience. Understand what it means to be a commercial lawyer, which is you have to, the client wants a
tot
solution to a problem. Or they need to know, can they do something, yes or no? If the answer is no, give me an alternative.
This is really solution-oriented lawyering.
This is more and more what
really
the legal profession is in Romania.
Rând,
it was not so prevalent 20. There was exceptions. Some of these top law firms you mentioned were very good.
There were other law firms
which were maybe, or lawyers that were practicing in the old way. And
yeah.
Clients don't tolerate this. In the age of instant communication, you know, you can't tell your client, well, at 5 o'clock on a Friday, don't call me until Monday morning. You have to be available. And, you know, the young lawyers all understand the technology. They're all available.
Acum,
so I think the quality of the lawyers across the board has increased tremendously.
Avocații
again, because they've been exposed to more of these deals. But what this has done for us is it create a lot of pressure because there is a lot of business now out there. So you see all the best lawyers are heavily sought and they get, you know, it seems like every week you hear about one partner moving from one firm to another or they leave on and set up their own
avocații
firm.
Au, bineînțeles, acum mai mult, mult mai multe posibilități
and
în fiecare zi,
you know,
sau tot mai des migrează
across the table
de la
from
o casă de avocatură la alta, automat și experiența crește.
They're very good and they're as good as any lawyer you would meet on any global deal.
Din ce în ce mai mult,
so I think the quality of the lawyering,
la fel de bun ca orice alt avocat din Europa.
Litigation, but in the commercial law space, the level of sophistication and knowledge and capability has continued to improve in Romania.
Litigation
ceea ce privește avocatura comercială, observ o evoluție tot mai mare în acest segment.
It's exactly. You have to learn. It's a very, I mean, I'm speaking from some perspective.
Este un domeniu în care trebuie să înveți
for 6 years, 7 years. It's a lot of procedure you have to understand, and it's a lot more process. And it's in some ways pure with the law because you're saying this is the law, apply it to the facts, please give me a decision, Your Honor, and then the judge will analyze. Whereas, as you know, in commercial, a lot of times it's just like we want, you know, you want to buy something, I want to sell something. Mm-hmm. How can we contract? If problems arise, we can try and cover it through different mechanisms. Now, for example, in the old days, you'd have to worry about, you know, getting warranties
ce privește avocatura pură, aplici legea, convingi instanța,
dreptul comercial
este ceva mai complicat.
Este
vorba de tranzacții.
And so there's ways
automat
you can mitigate risk through insurance,
trebuie să fie mai mare.
Other tools that are available. So these sorts of products are now more present in the market, and the level of sophistication, the types of deals
este
that are happening now
are really on a par.
To learn and understand, and
you can draw
upon the expertise and knowledge of lawyers and other EU jurisdictions.
So it's
really raised the capabilities. I think it's forced a lot of the Romanian lawyers to have to know EU law because it's directly applicable in Romania, or it's transposed into the local legislation. So, so it's created. I mean, I would say for me, the first 10 years of my work here was sort of like the Wild West or the Wild East, I guess. It was more of a cowboy.
Este o evoluție pentru că în primii 10 ani de activitatea mea pe această piață, România reprezenta un fel de vestul sălbatic, totul era un dezorganizat în acest domeniu. Apoi a venit criza și automat după criză lucrurile s-au așezat.
The last 10 years, let's speak now on the final question of the TV show. Of the future, in the future, 10 years, let me know, do you think the future of lawyering in Romania, particularly in Romania, will be
dar și pe viitor,
by a major law firms like I mentioned before, Nestor Tsuka, I don't know, Popovich Nitzu, CMS, and so on, or maybe a medium-sized law firm in Romania was leading the game, Volta being one of them.
Yeah, I think it's hard to say. I think the interesting thing with the legal profession, or the let's say the legal market, is you've seen a lot of movement, okay, over the years. I mean, in the past you would see some of the prominent firms like Tsuka that you mentioned, which was a split up.
Cine dictează piața, avocații, casele de avocatură mai mari sau casele care acum vin din urmă, sunt la început de drum?
I think we'll continue to have a role to play because, frankly, they know the market and there's value in being an independent firm, whether it's even you have situations like conflicts that arise. So I don't think you're going to see one firm just sort of break out and dominate. I think there'll always be room for competition. I think what's been interesting is you've seen
o forță dominantă, un jucător pregnant al pieței pe viitor. Cred că există loc pentru toată lumea și pentru cei care vin din urmă și pentru dezvoltare.
Some of the large international firms
am văzut multă mișcare pe această piață. Au fost firme internaționale care au migrat, care au plecat de pe piață, altele care au venit.
Alții
care au fuzionat și s-au transformat în companii mai mari, mai
where you were going with the question, Andre, is the profession as a whole, because this is what we at Wolf Tyser are keeps us up at night, and that is with digitalization and the evolution,
provocarea este
digitalizarea. Like Watson and these programs that now can basically draft legal documents almost as, effectively, if not more effectively than lawyers, and
they
now have programs that can give you different business options, and so the idea is, will we become obsolete as a profession? And I think this is, again, what we struggle with, and I think our answer is, maybe we'll lose some of that low-value commoditization work where somebody could draft a lease, they could do it on a computer and fill in the blanks, and then the printer will spit out a completed lease, and then you negotiate a few terms. But I think on the really high-value stuff where lawyers need to differentiate themselves and say, I am a valued advisor, a trusted advisor is the term we use. So if you're in a room in a heavy negotiation and you're about to spend, I don't know, 10 million euros on something, do you really want to rely on a computer program or a model? You're
going
to turn to the guy that you've done four or five other deals with and say, Joe, what do you think? What should we do here? What do you see? So there's always going to be that interpersonal aspect with a lawyer as a trusted advisor that I don't think will ever become obsolete. But what it might lead to is a transformation of the profession where, again, a lot of that lower value work may no longer be there. So there might be more
automat
of a consolidation
in the
industry, and there might be,
they're telling kids even
in the States. I have a nephew who's graduating next year from law school. He actually clerked for me one summer here at Wolf Tyser several years ago. But he's committed to becoming a lawyer, but he's looking at different areas like in data protection and cybersecurity, which are the new areas, which people think will be the growth area in law. Mm-hmm. And I think this is what I would advise anybody. I think that the law will still be relevant. But if I were a young law student or recently getting out of law school to go into practice, I would definitely focus on those areas where it would be much more difficult. Either it's a new area, so the knowledge isn't there, so you carve out a niche, or it's an area where it would be difficult for you to be sort of commoditized or replaced by a non-human, let's say, or artificial intelligence. So it's interesting times. I think for the next 10 years,
this is a period of time where I see some significant transformation.
I can maybe put in a plug for Wolf Tyser here in that we actually had recent partner elections for our management board, and we've just elected a new board in January. And
ceea ce privește noutățile din compania noastră, tocmai am ales un nou consiliu director.
Two of them are under 40 years old. Okay. And when one of them is a woman, so we're really evolving towards reflecting what we speak, which is, we're looking at the next generation, we're looking at diversity,
persoane tinere,
and we're looking really at being relevant for the next
generation. O generație tânără care vine din spate,
saying that you're able
puternică
to deal
și determinată.
With, cybersecurity issues as some of these older partners have trouble turning on their computers in the
domeniile,
fortunately, I'm not one of them, but you know what I mean. I think it's an evolving area, and so the lawyers really need to develop the next generation of young lawyers who are relevant and understand these areas that are going to be increasingly in demand for the new digital economy.
Thank you for being here alongside of me, Mr. Brian Jardine, managing partner of Voltais Bucharest.
Thank you, and happy July 4th.
Happy July 4th to all of you. Thank you very much.
Tomorrow
it's your
national day.
Indeed it is. Indeed it is. Well, thank you so much. It's always a pleasure to speak with you, Andrei, and you're doing an excellent
job. It's a wonderful
program, and I appreciate all you're doing to sort of air
out different issues and points of importance.
Thank you, Mr. Jardine. I'm waiting for next time here on Legile
Afacerilor. Această
Legile Afacerilor ia o pauză, ca mai toată România toropită de căldură, pentru 2 luni. Ne revedem la începutul lui septembrie. Până atunci, să aveți o vară frumoasă. La revedere!